Hello everyone. I'm really happy to be here and sharing the stage with Gurvinder, who I think is one of the most exciting filmmakers making films today. And discussing the idea of the seminar with him yesterday led us to an image which I'd start with before reading his bio note. The word poesis in Greek actually means both the art representation and the craft of making. So carpenters would also be engaged in poesis, so would the poets. And this is something Rancière has pointed out in other works, but the way we were thinking of it is that can storytelling be thought of as an artistic labor, as something that someone labors upon? And if it is a kind of labor, if storytelling is a kind of labor, how does cinema engage with the exact same labor but doing various things with it? And the image that we were sharing was from this commentary by the German poet Rainer Maria Rilke, who writes on Rodin. And he was spending long stretches of time in Rodin's studio, and he said that the poem is not something that is created on a blank sheet, but the poem is something that, like Rodin's stone, is already latent within the stone. So instead of writing, or instead of act of poesis or creating something new, he's merely clipping away what is superfluous in language. And that is something I started thinking about with Gurvinder, and we thought that probably in filmmaking, because the object of representation is already so complex and is already there, the idea of making or the idea of storytelling is significantly different from the idea of storytelling in a literary work or in a poem, because the object, the abstract complex, as we call it, is something that is already present before the camera even begins to do its work. So with that, I'd give a brief bio note of Gurvinder, and then he'll speak for around 8-10 minutes.
First, I think we'll watch a clip from.
We'll watch a clip from one of his films, and then he'll speak for 10 minutes, and then a discussion. So, Gurvinder Singh studied filmmaking at FDII Pune, graduating in 2001. He travelled extensively through Punjab between 2002 and 2006 under grants from IFA. Living and wandering with folk itinerants, documenting folk ballads and oral narratives. It led to his first documentary called Pala. He continued to make short experimental works and documenting arts and artists for the next few years. In 2005, he was invited by the avant-garde Indian filmmaker Manikol to be his teaching assistant for a master class at FDII, which led to a close association with the filmmaker who became his mentor. He translated and published a book of conversations with Manikol titled Uncloven Space. He has directed two features in Punjabi, Anhe Gode Da Daan, Arms for the Blind Horse in English, and Chauthi Koot, translated as Fourth Direction, which has premiered at Venice Film Festival in 2011, at Cannes Film Festival in 2015. His films have travelled widely to various film festivals including Rotterdam, Busan, Munich, London, Rio de Janeiro, etc., beside the Museum of Modern Art, New York. He has won the Special Jury Award at Abu Dhabi Film Festival and the Grand Prix at the Belgrade Auteur Film Festival, the Silver Screen Award for the Best Asian Film at Singapore. In 2016, he directed a short film, Infiltrator, as part of an international omnibus of 10 short films titled In the Same Garden. He lives in the Himalayan state of Himachal Pradesh in India, where he farms and runs a cafe. Gurvinder.
Thank you, Mantra. Thank you. The name of the cafe is Cafe Cloud Door.
Which is
it's a short film by Manikol. And so where I live, we are constantly in the clouds. And one day I was standing outside my house and looking at the clouds, which were just covering the entire valley. And I was thinking for a name of the cafe. And I said, cloud, cloud, cloud. And then I said, oh, cloud door. Why not cloud door? So we'll start with a clip from my first film, Anne Ghode Da Daan, which is Arms for the Blind Horse. The film is based on a novel by Gurdayal Singh. So we'll we'll have a look at the clip and then we'll come back here.
ਕੇ ਕੁੱਟ ਚਾਹ ਹੀ ਕਰ ਲੈਂਦੀ ਸੁਣਿਆ ਨੀ
ਤੇਰਾ ਬਾਪੂ ਕੀ ਕਰੀ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਜ਼ਿਆਦੇ ਕੁੱਟ ਕਰ ਦਿਓ
ਟ੍ਰੇਨ ਨਾਲ ਗੱਲੀਆਂ ਹੋਈਆਂ ਪਈਆਂ, ਕਿੰਨੀ ਵਾਰੀ ਕਿਹਾ ਚੱਕ ਕੇ ਅੰਦਰ ਰੱਖ ਲਿਆ ਕਰੋ।
ਉੱਠ ਜਾ ਹੁਣ, ਨਹੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਬਾਪੂ ਲੜੂਗਾ। ਤੂੰ ਅੰਦਰ ਵਗ ਜਾ ਬਾਪੂ, ਐਵੇਂ ਠੰਡ ਲੱਗ ਜੂ। ਚਾਹ ਮੈਂ ਅੰਦਰ ਲੈ ਆਉਂ।
ਉਹ ਨਾ ਮਾਰ ਬੇਜਵਾਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ, ਤੜਕੇ ਭੁੱਖਣ ਪਾਣੀਆਂ ਦੇ ਹੱਡ ਭੰਨਣ ਲੱਗ ਪਿਆ।
ਉਹ ਤੁਹਾਡੇ ਚੋਂ ਹੈ ਜਿਉਂਦਾ ਜਾਗਦਾ ਕੋਈ? ਚੱਲ ਉੱਠ, ਪੰਚਾਇਤ ਸੱਦੀ ਜਾਂਦੀ ਆ।
ਕੀ ਹੋਇਆ ਚਾਚਾ, ਕੋਈ ਗੱਲ ਤਾਂ ਦੱਸ ਜਾ।
ਤੂੰ ਗੱਲਾਂ ਫੇਰ ਪੁੱਛਦੀ ਰਹੀ ਕੁੜੀਏ, ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਆਪਦੇ ਬਾਪੂ ਨੂੰ ਘੱਲ ਠਾ ਕੇ। ਗੱਲਾਂ ਦਾ ਤਾਂ ਅਜੇ ਉਦੋਂ ਪਤਾ ਲੱਗੂ ਜਦੋਂ ਸਾਰਿਆਂ ਨੂੰ ਬੈਠਣਾ ਪਿਆ ਰੋਹੀ ਬੀਆ ਬਾਣ ਚ।
ਸੇਤੀ ਚੱਲ,
So this was a prologue from Anne Ghode Da Daan, or Arms for the Blind Horse, a film dealing with the angst, alienation and exploitation of the marginalized lower castes in the Punjab. Based on the novel of the same name by the celebrated Punjabi writer Gurdayal Singh. When I completed the film and shared it with the prestigious International Film Festival, the director of the festival very enthusiastically had it included in the program. I could not have asked for more for my debut feature. But my joy at having been selected for this elite festival was short-lived, as within a few days, I received a list of suggestive cuts, which, though not obligatory on my part to implement, was nevertheless asked to seriously consider for the betterment of the film. And a major part of this suggested overhaul of the film included getting rid of this prologue. The programmer argued that it does not in any way impact the story of the film, that the story could very well begin post this waking up, family waking up sequence, as the conflict is posited post this movement. And it's better to get directly into the meat of things than create a framework to enter into. An argument not dismissible in its entirety, if the only purpose of cinematic narrative was to posit cause and effects, conflicts and resolutions, or a continuum of those. But is that the only reasons films are made and viewed? What would be lost if I were to remove this entire segment from the film? What would the film gain other than reduced time length, if that was a welcome gain in the first place? For me, it was very clear that the film would become experientially poorer. It might not be affected spatially or thematically, but the quality of experience and attention would undergo a drastic change. And if the film underwent an experiential change, whose film would it be? According to Bergson, the whole is not given or givable, because according to him, it is the open, because its nature is to endure constantly, or to give rise to something new, in short, to endure. Each time we find ourselves confronted with a duration or in a duration, we may conclude that there exists somewhere a whole which is changing and which is open somewhere. Was the curator looking for a quick closure and did not have the necessary quality of attention to endure? Or was she acting and forewarning me on behalf of a perceived audience which lacked this quality? Perhaps. I stuck to my guns and refused to oblige the festival curator, which perhaps riled her, and she till date has not seen me eye to eye. Though the festival did screen the film, I was given a cold shoulder at the event, even being informed that my refusal to comply with the suggested cuts finished my chances of winning any award. The curator even refused to sit me for the interaction with the press. Welcome to the world of curatorship, I said. But such instances only steal your resolve and make you even more stubborn to inflict the misery of attention on your audience. Attention or dhyan, an idea I first came across sitting in a classroom with my teacher Manikol. Till then, the word only conveyed an idea of command and discipline, forever having been told in school to pay attention. I wondered what it had to do with cinema. Having been taught in film school that film thrived on privileged instants, on the Eisensteinian model of movements or developments extracted from moments of crisis, on collision of ideas and thematic reasoning, enduring or attending to information, however sparse or saturated, and unfolding in time was perhaps what had escaped all of us. It completely changed my way of looking at cinema, of looking through the camera. From an obsession with space and information, I started seeking out duration, time, and attention. The film turned from a visual art into a delightful form of time. From information juxtaposed from one set to another set, it turned into a juxtaposition of attentions and durations, of tonalities and temporal volumes. It got me rid of the notion that cinema was a visual art. The visual was easy to grasp and create or recreate. The way of seeing, the angle of seeing, the light, the objects constituting this seeing, the graphic quality of the image were all in the domain of the visible. It was the material of cinema, concrete and tangible, that constituted narration in conjunction with a relay of words. But without knowing, the obsession with the image had become a hindrance. Was it merely information that one was chasing? How could an image turn from carrier of information into a carrier of feelings? I got back to my own experiences of reading literature, listening to music, and watching films. The films that had me hooked were films which I could not grasp, the films in which I was not even mentally present in the world of the story unfolding on the screen. The best films were the ones which took me elsewhere. Or reading 100 Years of Solitude without even bothering to know about the XYZ of the story and its plot points. Just going on reading because it was a thrill to read, because the words were a delight to confront, because the descriptions were leading to vivid imaginations of spaces and textures and smells and sounds and faces and colors. The writing was leaving impressions which one need not decode, but which left one with a sense of curiosity about the external and internal world. If someone asked me what the story was, I could not even say a sentence about it. At least that is my memory of it now. Or maybe I could at that time. Bergson, in the first chapter of Matter and Memory, theorizes, there are not only instantaneous images or movement images, there are finally time images. That is duration images, change images, relation images, volume images, which are beyond movement itself. That which is beyond movement has to be beyond the spatial, beyond the visible and graspable. Can duration itself be that image? If evocation of feelings is the ultimate goal of cinematic storytelling, then perhaps yes, duration can be that carrier. The resonance of an image of a tree unfolding in time will undergo drastic changes in perception. First, of course, in relationship to the set of images it is juxtaposed with, but more significantly, with the time volume it occupies in the unfolding set of durations. The immediate feeling will, of course, be decoded from the presentation of the angle of view, the magnification of its physicality, the distance of view, the quality of light falling on the tree and its surroundings, and whether there is movement of objects impacting its presence, or whether the camera itself is mobile or immobile. This decoding is literally linked to the essential time required for this information to register. Let's say there is an objective idea of this time duration. The Hollywood director or the editor will say, cut, that's it. I need not show it longer. It has done its job. Let's move on to the next set. But perhaps someone else will come along and say, I am totally immersed in it and would want to stay immersed a little longer. Please let me pay attention for a longer stretch of time. It is evoking many things for me which I cannot describe. I am immersed in the experience it is creating for me. Or just the opposite, someone else would say, I don't want the feeling to register completely. It should be just like a whiff of smell which came and vanished, leaving you wondering where it came from and where it disappeared. But it has carried your senses along or even distracted them. It has provoked your sensibility to wonder. Both, according to me, are valid means to feelings. one perhaps leaving you breathless and the other perhaps leaving you restless. The objective sense of duration is perhaps the most obvious, which kills your sensibility to wonder. Because that sense reduces every set of objects to having a similar set of notions for the viewer. It reduces the seen and the seer to an average sensibility of meaning and looking and grasping things. Cinema, seen as a series of object sets organized to create a series of qualities of attentions, each one having the possibility of being abruptly killed in an instant and reborn with a new condition. As Gilles Diller said, the further duration descends into the system like a spider, the more effectively it creates the outer field and fulfills its other function, which is that of introducing the transpatial and the spiritual into the system, which is never perfectly closed or decoded. Bresson, Robert Bresson, made this into an ascetic mode. The more his image is closed, even reduced to two dimensions, the greater is its capacity to open itself onto a fourth dimension, which is time, and onto the fifth, which Diller calls the spirit. To quote Robert Bresson, if an image looked at by itself expresses something sharply, if it involves an interpretation, it will not be transformed on contact with other images. The other images will have no power over it, and it will have no power over the other images, neither action nor reaction. It is definitive and unusable in the cinematographer's system. Apply myself to insignificant or non-significant images. What is this non-significant, and what is its importance in the scheme of storytelling, especially for the filmmaker? Our lives don't comprise of significant instants every moment of our breathing. So why should a work of art aspire to that unrealistic objective? To create is to tie new relationships between persons and things. And extended to film, it involves tying new relationships between time itself, which can give rise to new feelings. And as Bresson said, let it be the feelings that bring about the events, not the other way.
Thank you, Gurvinder, for that. Now, my job from here is a straightforward one. I have a few questions that I'll ask Gurvinder, and probably through those questions, we'll parse through some of the ideas that he has already highlighted in his dense prose. The first question actually has to do with narrative and storytelling, and I'm not sure that everyone in this room is very familiar with the division between the two in cinematic thought or cinema making. Narrative is not only is not essential for filmmaking, as Kaul argued. He said, I'm not against story. People normally think of story and narrative as the same thing, but for Kaul, they are distinct. Narrative for him was what dictated meaning of the story and was thus something to be done away with. Story is something he wanted to keep, except that he allowed the camera to take control of the process of storytelling. So the question to you is, how has the narration and storytelling been different for you, or have they? And there are multiple moments in both your feature films which I think they make that distinction, and sometimes they kind of blur those distinctions. So would you want to speak about it?
As I said, there are certain significant moments. You know, when you plot a story, there are, in cinematic terms, there are significant moments which you want to arrive at. Now the question is how you arrive at those significant moments. You know, they can't just be given on a platter. So you create a framework to arrive at those significant moments. Like this prologue is, the whole aim of the prologue is to arrive at something. You know, it may not mean anything in itself. The information it is giving is an everyday event in a family which wakes up. The father wakes up first, the girl wakes up, the mother asks her to make tea, the boy takes the goats out for grazing. That's it. And perhaps the family wakes up like this every day. There's nothing new in that. But today, a house has been demolished. And they wake up to this information that a house has been demolished. So, perhaps what the curator wanted was the film to start right from where the whole village is gathered, and you know they're discussing why was the necessity to evoke this family's life, ordinary life every day. And coming to the question of narrative, I think there are two kinds of films. There are films which record events, and there are films which use the camera to create narrative. When I say narrative, create narrative, it need not necessarily be staging. It need not necessarily be staging of actors and dialogues and story. It need not be a kind of a direct depiction of events. Like in this whole film, the relationships between people never become clear to a lot of the audience. And I never made an effort to keep that relationship clear, because I was constantly resisting that things should not be, you know, this was an obsession initially, that things should not be clear. They should remain obtuse, and things should remain in fog.
Have you ever felt the need to distinguish yourself from the pre-cinematic forms of, let's say, literature, theatre, or photography? Despite both your films being adaptations of earlier literary work, do you feel your cinema has moved against the storytelling zeal of their literary counterparts?
I will talk a little bit about adaptation, because that's what I've been doing for some time now. When I read a work of literature, let's say a novel or a short story, there are many stories I want to make a film about, but many stories I can't think of a form. You know, I can't arrive, when I read something, I cannot think that how I'm going to, whether it serves my purpose, my cinematic biases. But if the moment I read something and I know it serves my biases, then I'm completely interested in adapting it. Of course, there's the question of the theme, the content, whether you relate to the story, the characters, what you want to say. But initially, the first thing I'm moved by is the rhythm, the structure, and my own idiosyncrasies, you know, how it will lend itself. So immediately there's a kind of, you know, I can see the film in front of my eyes at that moment. And it need not be great literature. Sometimes I've read very poor, ordinary stories, poor literature, and I'm like so moved by them, imagining the film it can be.
But when you imagine it, is it as a story or is it something else?
No, it is just rhythms. It's just abstract. It's a very abstract imagination. It is not, the story is there, of course, you know. But I imagine it as abstract rhythms. That's it. I imagine it as a series of attentions, a series of durations, as film will, and the relationship of the of temporal time with cinematic time, you know. In this film, the film unfolds, the story is over 24 hours. If you see the whole film, the event happens over 24 hours. And then how those 24 hours you compress into. In cinema, you're always compressing or expanding time. So how am I going to compress time or expand time? That is the interest. That is the cerebral challenge for me when I read a story.
I would want to pick up the idea of duration a little further. If you could unfold that for us, and this is something that we also shared yesterday, where. One of the earliest film watching experiences that Cole describes when he looks at a documentary, he says that the camera is observing a tree, observing people, and the film is getting made. Do you feel that this could happen to cinema that does not seek its validity in story? it becomes a piece of duration or movements or rhythms, as you're talking about. Is that moment of duration accessible only when you transgress storytelling? For example, this short, if you could kind of...
No, I don't think it has to transgress. It is not about storytelling or not storytelling. Even a very a film which is telling you a very kind of, you know, a story which is riding on plot points, fixed plot points, can talk about duration, can talk about attention, can evoke feelings. But sometimes even an abstract film need not do that. So it's not about abstraction or storytelling, you know. It's not about story or the lack of it.
What do you think is the relationship between story and meaning? A lot of viewers still find the meaning of a cinematic work residing solely in the story, which was the case, by the way, in most of the reviews that were published of your work in mainstream Indian press, because they chose to focus on what was happening in terms of the story. Can this be completely denied? One is obviously not arguing for solipsism, but how far does art need to respond to the charge of meaning? And is story one of the many compromises that filmmaking makes in the process?
I mean, our mainstream film criticism is, of course, only about the stories. And most of the film critics, I don't want to criticize film critics now, come on here, you know. So, I mean, they...
I could point to a specific one. There has been someone writing in Variety who saw the film in Cannes, Chauthi Koot, the other film that Gurvinder has made. This is his first feature. The second one that he made, which is now available on Netflix. So one of the film critics writing for Variety thought that the film was solipsistic and didn't do enough to the dramatic intensity of the plot, which is, again, a big lacuna in cinematic thought when you stick to the story and not to the form. And the problem that the critic has, the one writing for Variety, is that he feels that the drama is the dramatic intensity of sick anti-sick riots is something that is not... does not get that kind of unfolding in the form you chose to give it.
I mean, that's his opinion, you know. So, and this critic has particularly been harsh on me every time I make a film. And I look forward to his review, and it's always very predictable. And as I finished my talk, I said, as Bresson says, you know, that let the feelings arrive at the event, not the other way. Perhaps... I don't expect everybody to be able to see the film in the same manner. You know, I don't want everybody to see the film in the same way. And I have nothing against if he's not able to understand the sensibility behind the work.
So, should we open it for discussion?
Yeah.
Yeah. Questions from the audience?
You make the observation that you didn't want things to be clear. Let them remain obtuse in your observation. What was the objective that was being served by this approach? Another quick question. You have been a shagird of Manikov. I've seen his films in the earlier days in Bombay when they were first beginning to come out. And there's some reviews even. What has impacted you from his work or from his... I don't think you use him as a creative director. How has he impacted your work?
I think that...
Clarity?
For me, you know, it's about making a film is about creating an experience. And if you create an experience, the experience should have depth where the experience can be accessed again repeatedly. A lot of films you see it once and you don't have any desire to see it again. But can there be a cinema which can aspire to, like, say, music, you know? You can listen to the same piece of music again and again. And there is no story in it, there is no information in it. Can cinema aspire to that quality of experience? Where every time you see a film, you can say, wah. Or you can say, kya cut hai? Kya shot hai? What is that? Can this feeling arise every time you repeatedly watch a film? Perhaps I'm being too ambitious in trying to do that. Perhaps I don't have the skills to do that. I'm just trying. But when I was with Mani, that was an obsession. So that was the single most influence of his. And the other big influence of Mani was to get me rid of the idea of duality. He would say that there's nothing right. Let's get out of this idea of right and wrong. That we have this idea that this is the right shot, this is the wrong, it's not the suitable shot, or this is the wrong shot. He said there's nothing right or wrong, or there's no right or wrong way of doing. And he said this idea of duality is linked to your own swabhav, to your nature. You can do things in a certain manner which others can't do. We're all chasing originality, you know. I want to make an original film. I want to express in an original manner. But what is this originality? There's only we are original. I am original, you are original, he's original. And how do we arrive? And that is our swabhav, that is our nature. If we understand our nature, then this whole restlessness to find something original will automatically disappear. And that nature, and there is nothing like and that nature has no shortcoming. Actually, what you think are the shortcomings are the strength of that nature. But the way we are taught, the whole education system is predisposed to telling you that this is your shortcoming, that this is not going to work. The way you take shot is not going to work. The way you write is not going to work. But if you make that shortcoming your obsession, perhaps it can lead to something significant. So we would always talk about, you know, this idea of duality and non-duality and swabhav. These are the things he always emphasized on. And as a teacher, he was, I think, he never taught his way of filmmaking. So if there were 10 students in the class, he would want each one to look at things differently and try to understand the difference between each other. So in fact, we became in the class quite aware of the huge, you know, we were like, most of us were poles apart from each other. And then I realized, you know, the whole teaching was geared towards teaching you certain standards, certain conventions, and certain aesthetics of filmmaking. A lot of people say cinema is a language. But what is the language of cinema? Cinema has no language. Cinema has no syntax, it has no grammar. Cinema is information. And it is up to the filmmaker how you present that series of informations. So there are no rules to it. There are conventions. Often the conventions are mistaken for language. So once you get rid of this notion that there is a set grammar, that there is a language of creating films, I think you feel so free and so wonderful that you're working in a medium which has no language. It only has conventions, and it's up to you to regard or disregard those conventions, throw them in the dustbin or use them when you want to.
I just found the prologue absolutely haunting, and I don't know anything about this film till it was described after you had actually shown that. But I was just thinking about the images of the Indian village. And like you said, it's very everyday scenes. They're waking up, they're drinking tea. There is nothing especially portentous about those images, but already from the first few minutes, I started feeling a sense of unease, like something bad is going to happen very soon. So is that because I'm responding to a convention of the Indian village being a place where bad things happen? Or is it that there is something, because I love the small details, like how he tells her the kindling is wet, you should have kept it inside, or it's obviously very cold and they're not warm enough. So there are small clues about discomfort, but there's nothing, there's no spectacular problems at the moment, but you're still feeling something is wrong. And why was I feeling that? I was just curious if you wanted to respond to me.
I think maybe somebody else can respond to that.
No, I think what Anju might be asking, if I can just...
I've understood her question. Yeah, yeah. I want you to respond.
Yeah, I think one of the problems of latching on to the story in the way Gurvinder makes films is that to be expecting the horizon of expectations that we kind of watch films with is constantly broken in cinema of the kind that he makes, where we're expecting trouble, where we're expecting event in that sense, the event against the ordinary, and then nothing happens. It's duration. You sit in the theater, you sit on your seats, and the landscape shifts, and you're just gliding from one moment to another. So as he's saying, I think it's just the experience of that is offered of the Indian village rather than anything else. The plot details will obviously filter in. The cold or the abjection of a village will be there, but I don't think they'll become part of the way the story is told. They're rather small details that fit in into the larger duration.
But you've got the importance of the prologue. So, you know, for me it was inconceivable that I had to remove it. You know, I just couldn't accept that suggestion. I thought it was quite insensitive on part of the programmer to suggest something like that, and then objecting to the fact that the titles come in after 7 minutes of the film. You know, so I've seen films in which opening titles have come in the middle of the film. Why again conventions? You know, why bother about conventions? It's not a novel where you have to have a title on the front, on the cover of the novel. I think let's print and make a novel in which the title is in the middle of the, and you start reading novel from the cover. Why can't we do that?
Yeah, there.
Yeah, yeah, he's been.
I also think you were right not to let them cut this prologue. Which leads to my question. I was reading this essay by Amit this morning about many things, but it set me to thinking about Kutsia and Naipaul and their and your remarks about Bergson also got me thinking about Proust and how they all in common have this insistence on the absolute tyranny. Really, the absolute control of the creator over his material, to such a degree that the real tyranny has been properly established when the voice of the author disappears. And in your prologue, I was thinking how much it reminded me of Tarkovsky and Stoker, and again this like radical the control of the authorial voice to such a degree that. Finally, he reaches this point at which he manages to make himself disappear. And I was wondering, this question of authority, we haven't really talked enough maybe yet about storytellers as opposed to storytelling, but this question of authority, how do you recognize as a director
when you've sort of reached this point where you are no longer visible in the film, but suddenly now, because of your authority over the film, the film itself is capable of emerging.
I mean, that's... I would like to disappear one day from the film. But I think that needs years of labor and thinking. You know, I always think of this idea of simplicity. I was very obsessed with the idea of simplicity to begin with. And then I want to make something very simple, you know, which seems like very organic, natural, which doesn't seem constructed, which doesn't seem authored. But how do you arrive at something like that? It's not an easy... It's very challenging, you know. And I remember Matisse talking about simplicity. So Matisse says there are two kinds of simplicity. One is the simplicity which you strive at from the beginning, you know. You want to be an artist and you want to make something very minimalistic. Not say simplistic or minimalistic, actually. And there's another kind of simplicity which you arrive after years of complex working. So if you look at Matisse's work, towards the end he was just making simple strokes, you know. Even Paul Klee, from very complex arrangement of colors, you know, he was just making childlike drawings towards the end of his life. So what is the journey of the artist, you know, from very complex, very woven, knitted kind of work into just like trying to be childlike? I don't know. I mean, I don't know if how would one do that in cinema. I don't know what trajectory it can take. I don't know. I mean, only by doing you get the answers. There is one day I would like to make a film which seems like completely like, you know, it's emerged out of the earth.
Thank you, Gurvin.
Process of distillation, maybe.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, can we take this question outside? There's no time.
Just for last question.
Last question. Okay.
He raised his hands first.
Now, it just out of curiosity or for the sake of discussing, but in your paper you were insisting a lot on temporal volume, time volume, sometimes letting us believe that is the ultimate scenes when you are doing a film. And at the same time, in one of your answers, you were insisting on the fact that you are trying to create an experience for the audience. So my question, which is a little philosophical and stupid, it's finally time is not, time or duration is not only a tool, but not the ultimate thing. Because what you have been telling about time and movie, I have listened the same about theater, and suddenly singing, I'm saying, no, time is just a tool. You can choose the duration of an image, you can choose the duration of your film, but it's a tool for something else. It's not the ultimate.
Yeah, of course, I mean, what Deleuze calls the fourth dimension, or the extra spatial. So it's, I mean, and with that is linked to the idea of what you show and what you don't show. Because as a filmmaker, when you think of constructing, you're not only, you're constantly thinking of the off-screen, the off-field, the out-of-field. How, without showing, you evoke. And does time play a role in that? In what you don't want to show and just want to evoke? I'm also trying to understand it. I don't have any answers, you know. Of course, I understand that you don't give certain information. Suppose if it's just two people talking, I have my camera on one person, I never show the other person. And the other person is only present as a voice, as sound, as opposed to a shot where I see both of them. If the content is the same, two people talking, I'll hear what they're talking. But my experience, my feelings about that conversation will completely change. So, and in that also is the idea of the sound, you know. Because again, coming back, I mean, if cinema is temporal image, I think the sound is a greater carrier of temporality than image. And also because it's not just so, we only talk of visual image. We have visual image and we have the sound image. The sound is creating multiple images. The visual is still, you know, you are like, visual is like, it's like dictated. You have a frame and you cannot like be outside the frame, the visual. But the sound can be anywhere. The sound can be from anywhere. And so you have actually now, you know, with technology, we have like amazing possibility of working actually in sound. And when I think of my screenplay, I'm not only thinking of images, I'm writing sounds, you know. I'm writing sounds and I'm thinking of rhythms and durations, and then things work, you know. And actually, then you don't have to worry about images. The images will find their own relationship. They'll find their own resonance with each other. And sound will smoothen out everything. In fact, I'm more and more interested in sound than I'm in images now. Because images are so dictatorial, you know. Sounds are not. Still, sounds are still free of that. I mean, the sound of a train will evoke different things for different people. You know? The same sound can evoke different things. So for me, sound is a very important part of this idea of temporality and attention. Because the way the sound can grab your attention, an image cannot. And we are inundated with images now, you know, so the images don't have that quality anymore to move us, I think. Perhaps when cinematic images were rare and you could only go to a theater and watch, they had that power too, you know. So if you go to the era of silent cinema, I'm particularly, you know, I'm still, like say, German expressionism, you know. If you were to make films like that today, they will not have that power which they had at that time.